The main explanatory videos in the playlist are relatively short and compact, so that we can focus on the physical meaning of the concepts that we introduced in there. I supplement this by videos such as this one, where I go into some aspects in some more detail. This video is very special because I'm going to cover classical mechanics. This, of course, provides some important context and backdrop for quantum mechanics, and the people who developed quantum mechanics were deeply familiar with classical mechanics. Indeed, to a very sophisticated level, and in this video I just want to give you an idea how deep this can go. Indeed, if you come back to this video at the end of this course, you might well think that classical mechanics can be much more involved than quantum mechanics. And this is not completely false, because in classical mechanics you can have, for instance, chaos, which does not exist in the same way in quantum mechanics. And this is even though classical mechanics is a certain limit of quantum mechanics, and in which way this relation can be established is one of the purposes of this video here. What we are going to cover is Newtonian mechanics, which is a very general description of classical mechanical systems, which focuses on the acceleration of particles that experience forces, but also involves some notions of momentum and energy. But we will also cover some more powerful and general approaches, which have a much closer link to quantum mechanics, namely Lagrangian mechanics, which formalizes the role of momentum, and also involves an object which is known as the action, Hamiltonian mechanics, which tells us more how momenta and positions are really interlinked, and in this formalism, energy takes a much more central role. And finally, the Hamilton-Jacobi formalism, which is conceptually very deep and is actually not that useful for practical calculations, but conceptually extremely rich and indeed provides the most direct link between classical mechanics and quantum mechanics. So this ties really everything together. Some of these concepts will sound quite advanced, but these are all very powerful concepts, and the people who developed quantum mechanics were intimately familiar with them, so this really shaped the development of the theory. So from what I say here, it's clear that much of this will be for information. But let us start very simply, namely with Newtonian mechanics. So let us start with Newtonian mechanics. This is famously based on calculus, which was introduced by Newton to describe these kind of systems. So we have, for instance, positions, which depend on time. And then we can introduce velocities, which are derivatives with respect to time. And we denote them also with a dot. And accelerations, which are just an additional derivative. And all this contains the famous three laws, so that there is no motion without any forces. If the sum of all the forces acting on a particle is equal to zero, then this particle will not change its velocity. Well, we are talking about a particle with a certain fixed mass m. And now in the presence of forces, we have the equation of motion, which I write in an already slightly general form. And this is essentially the acceleration in the case that the mass is indeed fixed. And finally, if you have different particles interacting with each other, then the forces that they exert on each other are just opposite to each other. So this means that the force of one particle on another is a negative of the force experienced by that particle from the other particle. And everywhere in here, these understrokes denote that these are vectors. But this could also be a collection of the coordinates of many particles in Cartesian coordinates. So this does not just apply to a single particle, but also a collection of particles. Now, a simple example is a particle moving in gravity close to the surface of the Earth, so that there is a constant acceleration pointing downwards to the surface of the Earth. So I'm using a coordinate system in which this is basically the z direction. And now we can solve this by simply interpreting this as a differential equation and integrate this twice. With some integration constant which is related to the initial velocity. And another integration constant which is related to the initial position. And indeed, everywhere the mass appears. So we can just cancel it, assuming that it doesn't vanish. And of course, what we are doing here is non-relativistic classical mechanics. So if we call this coordinate the z coordinate, we find simply the following expression. While for the other directions, we simply find motion with constant velocity. And I'm sure you're very deeply familiar with this. This can really be represented as a parabola at the end. Now, another example would be the harmonic oscillator. Which I'm just going to specify in one spatial dimension. So there you have a force which is pointing back to an equilibrium position. And this is solved by some oscillating functions with an amplitude A and a time t naught, which is just a time where the displacement is maximal. And omega, the angular frequency of the oscillation, is given by this expression here. And you can check this by simply inserting this into the equation of motion. So taking the first derivative with respect to time, we simply get minus a times the sine function with this argument. But because time in there is multiplied by a constant according to the chain rule, also this factor omega in front. And then taking the second derivative, we obtain minus a omega squared times the cosine of this argument. But this is simply minus omega squared times the function with which we started with. And then we simply need to insert the definition of omega here to see that everything is fine. Now, Newtonian mechanics can become quite complicated when we look at slightly more general contexts. For instance, in the case of a rocket, we have an object that is losing mass at a certain rate mu. And if the rocket is moving at a velocity v, then the mass which is being expelled is moving at a relative velocity v naught. Now, this is clearly more complicated than the situation of a particle with a fixed mass. But it can be solved by introducing the notion of momentum and the idea that momentum is conserved. So we introduce momentum, P. And then Newton's equation of motion for any part of the system can just be written like this. And if we then add up all the momenta into a momentum capital P and use the third law that all the forces interacting between the different parts are sort of cancelling each other and we don't have any forces from the outside, then this total momentum will be conserved. Now the momentum of the rocket is just m times v, and the momentum of everything which is being expelled, let's call it the gas, can be written as an integral. We can simply collect everything which is being expelled at any point of time up to the time that we're interested in. And now we can simply say that these two add up to a constant. And let's just say that maybe initially this is just zero. So we start from the system at rest. Now we can simply take derivatives, which really brings us back to this conservation law. But this now reads, now doing the derivative here, we simply get mu v minus v naught. Now the total mass of the system is also assumed to be conserved, so m dot will have to be the negative of mu, so that everything which is being expelled is really lost by the rocket. So we find minus mu v plus m v dot plus mu v minus mu v naught is equal to zero, and these two terms cancel. And then we can bring some terms on the other side and insert here the explicit expression of the mass which follows from this equation here. And finally we can integrate all of this, and this just gives us a logarithm. I used the initial conditions already, so at time zero the velocity is really zero. V naught is not the initial velocity but the velocity by which the gas is being expelled. So this is known as the rocket equation. And this is now just one example that illustrates how complicated Newtonian mechanics can be, because it insists to work with these positions and velocities and accelerations. There is an even more important setting for this complication. To give you another example, let's look at a central potential. So that would be a potential which only depends on the distance to the origin, and in this situation it would be convenient to work with polar coordinates. I'm just going to do it in two dimensions, so we would have coordinates x and y, and we would parameterize them in terms of this radial distance and an angle phi, just as given here. Now then we would really like to change the coordinates to these coordinates here, and we can indeed do this, but it will turn out to be a bit more complicated. I'm going to denote this vector here now as r, so that we don't confuse anything with this x here. And I'm going to call this unit vector here er, because it points into the direction of the radial coordinate. So this unit vector would point in this direction here. And I'm also going to introduce another unit vector, which is given as minus sine phi and cosine phi. So this is just another orthogonal direction. And if we now simply start from the Newton's equations of motion, well, then we need to work out these derivatives. Now r dot can be written as r dot er plus r phi dot e phi, simply by taking derivatives and using our definitions. And the second derivative can then be written in the following way. Now, this is what we want to insert here. And here we want to insert the corresponding force, which would be the gradient of this potential. But for a central potential, this is simply proportional to the derivative with respect to r and er. Now we get two equations by equating the coefficients in front of this radial direction and in front of this other direction. But notice that this other direction does not enter in the force. So in particular, we get one equation by looking at this term here, multiplied by m, which is indeed convenient. And this we can integrate immediately when we recognize that what is given here is just a derivative of the following expression, which we call the angular momentum. And so this angular momentum does not change over time. So this is the so-called law of conservation of angular momentum in a central potential, here just in two dimensions. But this can also be generalized to three dimensions. And now if we look at the second equation involving this direction here, we find the following expression. And now this can be rearranged in a very useful way. As a derivative of an effective potential, which is simply given as V plus L squared divided by 2mR squared. So we can reinterpret this as an equation of motion of a point particle moving in one direction, but with a modified potential with some extra forces, which are known as fictitious forces. Now, this was actually a little bit complicated, and there are now more powerful formalisms in which such considerations become much easier. And as it happens, they are much more closely related to quantum mechanics than Newtonian mechanics. So let us have a look at those.